This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
See Live Off the Record with Zhivargo Laing is sponsored by Burger King, RF Bank and Trust, World Star Assurance, and New Life.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Be Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad that you could join us today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful, what day is it now? Tuesday afternoon. I trust and hope that you are doing well. So glad that you could join us here today. I have to say that that paying attention to the court ruling on this shantytown issue has really prompted me to consider a number of things related to it. And so that's what I am hoping we can discuss today. That ruling in a broader sense than simply, the ruling. I really want to ask a couple of pertinent questions and hopefully you can help me to weigh in on those questions regarding the whole issue of the shantytown. If you want to give us a call today, the numbers are 323-6232. That's 323-6232. Of course, you can always call us on, you can always text on the 422-4796, 422-4796, or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. That's 439-3043. We are, of course, live on Cable Bahamas, channel 969. That's the way my mother listens to the show. Or you can catch us on BTC Flow channel 612. That's BTC Flow channel 612. So, Judge Cheryl Grant Thompson has ruled that the government has to cease and desist from its destruction of the homes there in what we've come to call shanty towns there in Abaco. Now it's across Abaco, and she has apparently not bought the government's argument as to the legitimacy of its destruction of those homes, citing, as the government did, that it was destroying the ones that were built after Hurricane Dorian, and she wasn't satisfied. It seems that was in fact what was being done. And so now the court has ordered a managed process, meaning it wasn't that, it doesn't seem as if it is impossible for the government to proceed in doing any of the demolitions, but what it cannot do is it cannot do those demolitions without the approval of the courts. And so now all the folks concerned have a more structured way for this to happen. In many ways, for me, I see this, I don't see this as a victory any way or the other, even though it certainly delays, it certainly slows down the destruction of those homes for the people whose homes they were. But it seems that if the government comes and makes a case, as this particular one meets a particular criteria, perhaps the courts may say, okay, go ahead and do the demolition. But the legal arguments aside, I am wondering actually whether this shanty town demolition action on the part of the government, whether it is an immigration issue or a building code issue or what? What exactly is it that is being pursued here? Now, please correct me if I'm wrong. Any single body, including any politician, cabinet minister listening. The issue of shanty towns in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas has been longstanding. And I would dare say that they have been longstanding more as an issue of immigration than as an issue of building code. Because my sense is, my observation is, that where the issue of shanty towns came in mostly was an issue of illegal Haitian immigrants and our anxiety over the large numbers and continuous flux of illegal Haitian immigrants to the country. Because insofar as broad compliance with building codes are concerned, there are communities in the Bahamas, I should call no name, known to be inhabited by Bahamians, we believe, that one could well question compliance with building codes. Well question them. If building code violation represents a safety issue for the physical life and well-being of people, then there are any number of areas where one could ask the question whether or not, in fact, the building code of the Bahamas is being complied with. But they don't seem to get the same attention or focus, and to some degree, they certainly may not be as intensely, manifestly, what should I call it? You know, when you kind of hodgepodgely assembled as, say, the homes in these so-called shanty towns. But the truth of the matter is that there can be places where we could well question not only was the building code being observed, but why, in fact, people are living in those particular structures. And I know some where people live, where you could well question whether they ought to be allowed to live in such structures. Right, but in many instances, with those are not predominantly occupied by illegal Haitian immigrants. And so, what has happened in the Bahamas, in my observation from time to time, is when we have become particularly irate with influxes of illegal immigrants, and that often dependent on what was happening in Haiti at the time, whether some economic or a natural disaster prompted larger outflows of Haitians from Haiti into places like the Bahamas. And the mere fact that if they then came here illegally, a human being will try and find some place to accommodate themselves. And so they, many of them will end up accommodated in these shanty towns. And so the converging of the illegal immigration issue with the poor structures in some of these, in the shanty towns, created the kind of political heat that then prompted a response, depending on who the prime minister and who the politicians were, prompted a response from the government. Not all reacted and responded the same way. You get mad at me if you want. I really, honestly, at this point in my life, I really couldn't care that much. But there have been politicians in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas who have exploited these issues for their own particular political promotion. They exploited it to enhance their popularity. There was nothing to suggest that they really cared about this issue. Nothing at all, other than it was, and in the Bahamas, a quick and easy way to gain favor with large numbers of Bahamian people. If you go after the Haitian and go after the Haitians hard, if you go after the shanty towns and go after the shanty towns hard, you can get to become a popular politician, and people believe that you ought to be prime minister one day, you ought to be put on a pedestal, and that's the reality that has happened. There have been people who have been genuinely concerned about this issue, no doubt, but it has been exploited. And I dare say, again, you can get upset with me if you want, I dare say that to my mind, some of the approaches to dealing with this issue in this current environment was pandering. It's pandering. I think because it could have been approached and it could have been addressed differently if we can figure out what it is we are trying to do. Exactly. Okay, let me explain. And please feel free to weigh in. If it's an immigration issue, right? The question is, who are the occupants of the structures in the shanty town, so-called? Who are they? Are they Bahamians? Are they legal residents? Are they illegal immigrants? There was some survey that was done, I think aided by the Department of Statistics, and to my understanding, a very high percentage of the persons were legal, either Bahamians or legal residents. Okay? That's my recollection. So let's take the persons first who are illegal. Okay? Now, you are residing in these shanty towns and you're illegal. The first question arises is, okay, how do I know that you are illegal? How do I make the approach to find out that you are illegal? As I understand it, you can't just walk up to the person and demand identification. My understanding is that you can't just allege a person to be illegal. Like, you look illegal. You can't do that. Bahamians do that. Some Bahamians do that, but you can't do that. You have to have probable cause to approach a person that way. You have to have a probable cause, right? But let's say you get past the issue of probable cause and you have reasonable grounds on which to approach somebody illegally. If you find that this person is illegal, then that's dealt with in one way, because clearly there are laws in the Bahamas against illegally residing in this country. There's no question about that. So boom, you're illegal. Boom, we take the legal, lawful procedure and we deal with you. So that's dealt with that way. Now, if you then occupied a place in the community that's regarded as a shanty town, now the question of who owns that structure and that place becomes one of, for the people at public works in the building code section, and to, again, I assume there is a legal process of doing this to say, okay, you know, the structure is not up to scratch and you got to find the owner. I hardly believe that the illegal immigrant would have been the owner. Hardly believe that, okay? So there has to be some owner of the land, and whoever owns the land owns the structure, because structures don't own land, land owns structure, okay? So that's the illegal immigrant person and their facility. Then there is the issue of the Bahamian slash legal resident. You have a right to be in the Bahamas. So we're not, there's not, for you, it's no immigration issue. But you live in a place where someone is making the judgment that this place is unsuitable for human occupation. Who's making that judgment? Who ordinarily makes that judgment? Well, for us who have been in the building of our own homes and stuff business, we know that we couldn't get to occupy our homes, saving and accept. We got, if you are in all the places other than Freeport, you got an occupancy certificate from the Department of Public Works and their building code area. If you are in Freeport, that's the building control area of the Grand Bahama Port Authority. You don't get to occupy that home without their having issued an occupancy permit. And sometimes they can issue you a final occupancy permit, or they can issue you a temporary or conditional one, you know, subject to doing some work. Okay, so if there is reason to believe a building being occupied by a Bahamian or non-Bahamian, I mean, by a Bahamian or legal resident, then the issue becomes one of the approaching of the whoever the authorities are to inspect the place, and as they have done even with government buildings, deem the place unfit for occupancy and condemn the place. Now, here's where it gets a little tricky for us. And this is why I ask you, I'm asking you, is this an immigration issue, or is this a building code issue, or is it something else? Let me tell you why. I know of buildings in New Providence, government buildings that have been, end quote, condemned by public works, condemned. And not only do those buildings still stand, there was a period of time where they were still occupied, notwithstanding they were condemned. I believe one of those buildings was, in fact, a cabinet office building. So if a building is condemned, now I recall even during my tenure in office when the notion of the building having been condemned by public works really even became a political argument. You know what I mean? Whereas like the political establishment says to the technocrats, and y'all gotta be talking nonsense, but condemned. So we have scenarios where we seem to be contradicting our own condemnation of buildings. So these shanty towns, the buildings in them were, I suppose, deemed by the authorities as unfit for occupancy. They get to have a charged enthusiasm to destroy, to demolish them, whereas we seem to have more patience with others. Which is it? See, if we, one of the challenges that you can have in public policy is irrationality, or you can have discrimination, or you can have ineffectual application of the policy. Do we have a housing policy in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas? If we have a housing policy in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, it should be applied uniformly. Because in the application of it uniformly, you don't get charged with discrimination. Okay? We apply it uniformly. Our immigration policies ought to be applied uniformly so that the Haitian, the Jamaican, the Englishman, the American, those of various African, from various African countries, all Canadians, all get treated the same way under a common set of standards as it relates to our policy. It shouldn't be, while you may have a greater focus and attention paid to a group because of the numbers in which you have them, the application, though, of your policy is to be and ought to be equitably applied. And so, where else in the Bahamas are we pursuing building code enforcement as rigorously as we are enforcing them in the so-called shantytown areas, is a question I would have. I can tell you one thing. If you live in the Port Authority area, anyone who lives in Freeport can tell you, anyone who's been involved with building tech, they don't care. They don't care who you is. That building code can be enforced. Now, they have some officers who may be a little bit more lenient as to give you some time to come up to scratch, but it ain't gonna be much. They got some officers, man, they will lay the thing down like that. And so that somebody could claim discrimination there too often, it wouldn't be so, not in Freeport. So what is the shantytown issue, really? What is it that we are doing in the shantytowns, so-called? What are we doing? Are there Bahamians who live or lived in those areas? Are there legal residents who lived or live in those areas? What exactly are the violations that applied in those areas? Because maybe I am living in a structure myself that may have that same violation, and maybe I should know, because according to the actions, this is an unfit situation and I should not be living in an unfit situation. I may be a tenant, it may not even be my own place. But what exactly are the violations? See, this is public policy. This is public policy. This is not private initiative. This is public policy, and public policy is supposed to take place in the light of day, transparently and accountably. So why can't I know? We are seeking, and we will demolish these 510 buildings because these are the provisions of the building code, and they are in breach of these provisions of the building code. And they pose these dangers to the place. So forget the illegal immigrant now, because you let's say you catch them, you take them through your process, you deport them or you jail them, you do whatever you have to do with them, whatever the law requires. I don't have no problem with it. I'm not going to argue with the government about taking the law and applying it to a person in breach of the law. I'm not going to argue that. In fact, if that person is taken before the courts, I'm going to rely on the judges to make judgments that are consistent with our laws and good judicial practice. But for the Bahamian and the resident, we have a larger question to answer. And so we have to be careful about what may be a judicious use of political power for the purposes of pandering to a craved, to a hungry for resolution population of a particular issue. That the public of the Bahamas does not want shantytowns makes good sense to me. No one should argue with the Bahamian public who said, I don't want no shantytown in my country because they pose public health issues, they may pose safety issues, etc. No problem with that. That the public of the Bahamas does not wish to have illegal persons residing in the Bahamas is entirely appropriate. Entirely appropriate. Cannot have an argument with that. But when you are conflating these issues in a way that may appear panderous and political, then I have a problem with that. Because I assure you, y'all walk with me for a minute, please. Walk with me for a minute. Just bear with me for a minute. Let's suppose any one of those shantytowns were in fact an area over the hill occupied by, let's say, Bahamians entirely, let's just say. Entirely. There's no question, no doubt about it. Same shantytown over the hill occupied by Bahamians. How do you think a government of the Bahamas would approach that? You think a government of the Bahamas would ride in there with a bulldozer and just tear them buildings down? No, you really think so? Or might a government of the Bahamas go and have meetings with the community, go and bring the church and them into the picture, see how, okay, we can't have you living in this scenario, so maybe we have to see whether we can effect some repairs to make the place habitable, or if in fact we have to demolish it, we can find some place for you to live, so we got to deal with social services and what have you and get you transferred into another situation. I'm asking you to tell me, how do you think it might have been dealt with differently had they just been purely Bahamians, we thought on you? As a political consideration, as a matter of invoking the ire of Bahamians, how do you think the government of the Bahamas would have handled the issue? With grace? Or with brute force? With negotiations? Or with demands? How do you think it would be handled? Do you think it would be a matter before the courts today? We know better. Because we have seen how the government of the Bahamas handled issues in times past when it came to things affecting Bahamians. Meeting by the College of the Bahamas, meeting in the churches there, you listen, you get feedback from this one and that one and the next people, and then you try to move with the greatest of delicacy for fear that the people in there have family, got friends, and their family, their friends, well, depending on how you feel and you've been handled, will be affected by it, and so you pay attention to the politics that way. So I ask you, what is it exactly we are doing in these shantytowns? In the Coliseum, the crowds, seeing Maximus having felled the great gladiator who had never been defeated, the crowd started to shout, kill, 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 kill. Hungry for blood they were, this crowd. The king, listening to the crowd and therefore wanting to pander to them, the king said, put his thumb down. You know what the thumb down means? Yes, go ahead and kill him. Maximus raises his axe as if to go and cut off the head of the gladiator he had felled. And what does he do? He throws the axe away. Only to have the same crowd shouting for blood turn around and say, Maximus the Merciful, Maximus the Merciful, Maximus the Merciful. To the disgust, frustration, and irritation of Commodus the King. In politics, you have many judgments to make. One of them is when to see to the crowd, and one of them is when to not do so. One of the rules of public policy is never do it brute force, something that could be done without it and have the same or better effect. So, the court rules and says, no, what you're doing is not right. The government says it's going to appeal it. And you know, the government may appeal it and may win. But is that instructive? Is that instructive? Are not the people in those shanty towns people? Are they not human beings? And again, I ask the question, unless I am confused, unless someone who's listening to me can help me, am I confused in my recollection that the majority of persons in the shanty towns that they had surveyed were in fact Bahamians and or legal residents? Well, can then, I mean, so in the, what I'm going to talk about when we come back from the break is, what is our housing policy in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas for Bahamians and legal residents? What is our housing policy? What is the policy of the government of the Bahamas toward a human being who is a Bahamian or a legal resident having housing in the Bahamas? What's our policy? You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back after this break. We're going to take a break after this. We'll take a break. We'll be back after this break. I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
Work hard. Shouldn't your money be working hard too? RF Mutual Funds are designed to put your money to work with some of the best performing investment funds in the market and a range of funds to suit your unique needs and risk tolerance. So when you're hard at work, you can be confident your money is too. Put your money to work with RF Mutual Funds. Call us at 603-6000 or visit rfgroup.com to learn more. RF, money at work.
Your health is important. Don't trust it with just anyone. Welcome to New Life Natural Vegetation Cell Food Limited. We stock an extensive range of health foods, alternative medicines, and organic produce with a wide variety of special dietary foods, herbal teas, and herbal medicines. New Life also carries natural, organic, and environmentally friendly soaps, body lotions, and other skincare products. Stop by our state-of-the-art alkaline deli and try our all-healthy and all-natural tasty choices. Our knowledgeable and friendly staff can answer any questions you may have. We offer on-site consultations on nutrition, diet, and healthy alternatives to disease and ailments. New Life cares about you and your health needs. We're located in the Independence Drive Business Park, East Street South, south of the Independence Roundabout. Visit our website at www.newlife1020.com. Let your food be your medicine.
Marsh the cop?
I ain't Marsh the cop. The lady who run into me, Marsh the cop.
I hope she had insurance.
If she had insurance, she hop out, pull out her phone, pull up the Royal Star Assurance app, and bang, she was on a video call with an RSA rep, sending pictures of her damage, my damage, filing a claim on the spot.
For real? Our insurance have that kind of app?
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today or visit rsabahamas.com to submit your claim online. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad that you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Tuesday afternoon. If you want to give us a call, you can give us a call on 323-6232. That's 323-6232 or 325-431-6325-4316 or 325-4259, 325-4259. You can also text us on 422-4796. That's 422-4796. So you can WhatsApp us on 439-3043, 439-3043. We're talking about the ruling handed down by Judge Cheryl Grant Thompson regarding the demolition that was taking place in Shantytown there in Treasure Key, Abaco, in Abaco somewhere. Ruling that has now put a halt to the government's situation and now requires the government to enter into a more managed situation, a situation managed by the courts. And it has prompted me really to ask the question really of what is the Shantytown issue all about really? What is the policy? What is the policy pursuit? What is the policy objective? Is it an immigration objective? Is it a building code integrity objective? Is it a combination thereof? What is it exactly? What do we know exactly about what is being pursued in respect of the housing there? See, it's one thing to get caught up in the same thing that we sometimes get caught up in on the political side of things, okay? There are people who can be for Fred Smith and his group and what he's doing. And then there are people who can be for the government and what it's doing. I don't have an interest in either one of those sides like that. I'm interested in what are our aims and objectives and whether or not what we are doing is the most effective way to achieve those aims and objectives if we believe that they are appropriate aims and objectives to be pursued, right? Because again, as I have broken down, an illegal immigrant anywhere in the Bahamas, including in a so-called shantytown, can be apprehended through legitimate processes and dealt with through legitimate legal means. Boom. So their occupancy of any structure, whether that structure is in violation of the building code or not in violation of the building code, is irrelevant. Their entire occupancy of space in the Bahamas is illegal, and they therefore are subject to the laws and processes of the Bahamas. Now, a Bahamian or a legal resident occupying a structure, see, they have a right to be here. Okay, let's put it that, let's establish that. So you can't deport the Bahamian, and you have to have grounds to deport the legal resident, right? So you can't just deport them. They are here legitimately. And their occupancy of a space or a structure which they own or do not own is entirely a matter of their safety and that of the community in which they live. That's all that could be about. And so there has to be something not about them, but about the structure that is offensive to the rules of the country when it comes to building code. If they rent, then it is not them that are in breach of your rules, then it is the owner of the property that is in breach of the rules. If they own, then they are in breach of the rules, and they therefore have to be dealt with in accordance with the laws of the country. But these are Bahamians and legal residents. And if the matter is so dire, mind you, they've been living there for decades, some of them. If the matter is so dire, and it is their well-being, listen to me, folks, listen. All government practices, all policies, all efforts of leadership is to abound to the well-being of people. Of people. So you can't, on the one hand, say to people, I am concerned about your safety in a structure, and then turn around and throw you to the wolves because I'm destroying your structure. Because might there not be underlying socioeconomic issues that causes a person to believe they have to live in that condition, in that situation? I mean, let's be real, folks. There are people in the Bahamas today, Bahamians in the Bahamas today, whose economic circumstances, born of their own choices in some instances, but born of circumstances beyond their control, who are unable to afford to live in a place that they would ordinarily want to live in, and they are therefore living in circumstances that you and I both know is not suitable for someone to live in. You know that and I know that. Listen, when I was a member of parliament, I went down to in Baintown, one section of my constituency. I knocked on the door as I was doing visitations on that Saturday. The young lady invited us into the building, into the structure, wooden structure. God is my witness. She had a little infant in her hand, and in the middle of the floor of that building, of that structure, was a tire rim with coal in it that was the fire for cooking whatever she cooked. We had to turn over a situation to social services to try and get her some help for her certain circumstances, see if we could find her employment, engagement, because why was she living like that? Because she wanted to? So you have people whose circumstances right now today, they used to live in a 2-3-bedroom house. They used to live in much better conditions than they are people today who used to live with their family on their own. They now live with another family together. So might there not be mitigating circumstances that are driving people to live this way? And then if our concern is for people, and not merely making a political statement about the, in quote, illegal shantytown issue, might not our approach then be, okay, how do we assist your housing needs while at the same time we pay attention to this, in quote, dire building infraction issue that causes us a public safety concern? Tell you one thing, if Haitians were not involved, one has to wonder whether we might not approach it that way. If this wasn't a, in quote, designated Haitian community or illegal Haitian community, might we not address it, approach it that way. And I'm being in your face about this because I'm challenging the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. I'm challenging us. I'm challenging us to be more thoughtful, to be more innovative, to be more sophisticated in our approaches to the way we deal with human beings. We know that we have failed some things. We know that we have not gotten it right some things. All of us, whether personally and collectively. So no one need be defensive and go around looking for some reason to find salvation in this circumstance. But come on. The court just said, listen, bro, the approach you're taking ain't the right approach. Might we not think of a different approach? I bet you, if you have different leadership in some instances, you may get different approaches. You might. Right? Because there are different approaches that could be taken. One, approaches that can achieve all the ends for which we strive, including, most importantly, a dignified end for the souls, the people who we are seeking. Say, bro, this is by far the most cogent and comprehensive breakdown of the situation. Say, man, you preach. They would not bulldoze them. No one bulldoze a community full of Bahamians. I don't see it. This text says, thank you for outlining all the considerations that should go into making a decision to bulldoze the dwellings that someone should have noticed were being constructed. As you rightly point out, as an employer, government has neglected its health and safety responsibilities by continuing to occupy condemned buildings. This is only one example of the glaring inconsistencies in the government's actions in this regard. There you go. Couldn't have said it better myself. This text just says, good afternoon, sir. Good show as usual, Mr. Laing. Is there any human right agreement or any other agreement that the government signed on to preventing them from dealing with an illegal immigrant the same way they deal with Bahamians? The reason why I ask is because I recently decided to build a house on a property I bought in Exuma, and immediately on attempting to do so, the authorities stopped me and instructed me to wait until my plans are approved. Why can't the same be done in Abaco with all the resources the government has on the ground? Well, I don't know what the same or not same is, but that's a legitimate question. Let me tell you something about laws and agreement. I said this to you before, and I want to say this to you again. A law does not represent your highest ideal. It doesn't represent your best character. A law actually represents the minimal negotiated standard you could accommodate in a community of diverse people. All right, so the minimum I could do, listen, so let me give you an example. The law says thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not kill is not the highest ideal to which a human being or a community of human beings can strive. Thou shalt not kill. Okay, thou shalt not kill. Hate all you want. Envy all you want. Be jealous all you want. Talk bad about all you want. Insult all you want. I can't arrest you for that. I just only could arrest you if you kill. So a law and these agreements between nations and stuff, they represent the minimal negotiated standards that a group of diversified people could have amongst themselves. The highest standards come from your personal convictions. They come from a sense within you that there is a rightness, there is a higher standard to which I can and ought to appeal. And so, for instance, where the law says, thou shalt not kill, I go further and say, I shall love. So don't just ask me for no law, man, or no agreement. Because what you're asking me for is a minimum standard. And yes, we need these minimum standards because they set at least a floor. Okay? They set a floor for us to stand on. But if we are going to build, we have to find higher standards. That's why wisdom is important and understanding is important and knowledge is important, because beyond the mere letter of the law, there is a spirit underlying the law that has higher ideals. Those are the ones that make us look on illegal Haitians, legal Haitians, look on Bahamians, poor and rich, and say you are loved and you are valued and you matter. We're going to take a break for news. We'll be back after the news break.
I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid to take a stand. Take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand. Come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm. Whatever weather.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Good afternoon, Bahamas. You're listening to the Guardian News Network. I'm Taylor Ferguson. Here's what's making news. Thank you for tuning in. Government is taking its shantytown fight to the Court of Appeal now that Supreme Court Justice Cheryl Grant Thompson ordered it to cease and desist further demolitions in shantytowns on Abaco and ruled that government must get approval from the court if it wishes to demolish structures in shantytowns on that island. Attorney General Carl Bethel speaking briefly to the matter outside Cabinet this morning.
I met with counsel involved in the matter this morning. As well, we respectfully disagree with the reasoning of the learned judge. We respectfully disagree with the conclusions arrived at by the learned judge.
Works Minister Desmond Bannister is fuming over the judgment. He said it's a very dangerous ruling and called it a flawed decision, which is wrong in law, and they expect it will be overturned.
It is nonsense. It's not where the paper is written on, and the government is going to have to appeal it. For those of you all who know Abaco, and I know some of you all are from Abaco, they could go in Pelican Shores, they could go in Elbow Key, they could go in Treasure Key, they could go in any of these upscale areas, put a building there on somebody's property, don't care whose property it is, and in order to do something about it, they're not in breach of the order, but in order to do something about it, or enforce the law, the government is going to have to make an application to a judge. You know how silly that sounds?
The U.S. Centers for Disease Control has now lowered its travel advisory for the Bahamas from a level 4 to level 3. The CDC is still recommending unvaccinated travelers avoid non-essential travel to the Bahamas and warns all travelers here may be at risk for getting and spreading the virus. It added, the update to its travel notices seeks to better differentiate between countries with severe outbreaks from those with sustained but controlled COVID spread. It's a downgrade Tourism Minister Dionisio de Aguilar calls fantastic news. He told the Nassau Guardian, statistics for May show there is substantial interest in the Bahamas, particularly among group travelers, and he's hopeful the improved travel advisory will boost that interest and encourage more recreational travel to our shores. Well, despite the ongoing lockdown, both Andros and Cat Island recorded two more new COVID infections on Sunday, three new cases identified on Abaco, one on Exuma, and 12 on New Providence. A Grand Bahama woman died tragically last night following a traffic accident near Barbary Beach. Officers say shortly before 6 o'clock, the wife and mother was driving a white Daihatsu with two other occupants when the car collided with a green Ford Fusion driven by another female. The other driver and occupants were taken to hospital. The car crash on Windermere Drive resulted in the first traffic fatality for the year on Grand Bahama. Superintendent Jeremy Henfield says the island averages 20 car accidents a week. That's what's making news. I'm Taylor Ferguson. AP News is coming up next.
Meet Jackie. Jackie's a hard worker with a steady income, but she has a personal loan and multiple credit cards to pay off. To keep her account current, Jackie opted for a loan from Fidelity Bank to consolidate her debt into one monthly payment and earn interest on a built-in savings account. Be like Jackie. Call 356-7764 to book a complimentary financial coaching session. Fidelity also offers virtual assistance. Fidelity, we're good for you.
I'm Ed Donahue with an AP News Minute. A Senate report on the January Capitol riot found a lot went wrong, a broad intelligence breakdown across many agencies. But Majority Leader Chuck Schumer says there was no mention why there was a riot.
With the exception of a brief reference to former President Trump's remarks at the Ellipse, Senate Republicans insisted that the report exclude anything having to do with the cause of the insurrection.
The report says there were clear warnings and tips supporters of former President Trump were planning to storm the Capitol, but that intelligence never made it up to top leadership. Minority Leader Mitch McConnell says there's no need for another investigation.
Today's report is one of the many reasons I'm confident in the ability of existing investigations to uncover all actionable facts about the events of January 6th.
The report recommends immediate changes to give the Capitol Police Chief more authority. I'm Ed Donahue.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Tuesday afternoon. You can call us today on 323-6232. That's 323-6232 or 325-4316, 325-4316 or 325-4259, 325-4259. You can also text us on 422-4796. That's 422-4796. We're talking about the ruling handed down by Justice Cheryl Grant Thompson regarding the shantytown demolition that was taking place in Abaco. The government says it's going to, the judge ruled against the government, and the government said it's going to appeal that ruling. This text says, my view and understanding is that shanty towns have been occupied by both Bahamian citizens and foreign illegals, in particular Haitians. If an individual is here illegal and build contrary to the building code, the law must be enforced. On the other hand, if the Bahamian citizen builds contrary to the building code, the law should be enforced. So why then so much confusion of shanty towns being demolished? One is either breaking the law or not breaking the law. Well, let me say that in a way you are confusing the issue, because listen to what you say. If an individual is here illegal and builds contrary, the two of those don't even go together. If an individual is illegal, period, the law should be enforced. So what does building here have to do with anything, right? Secondly, if you are illegal in the Bahamas, how you get to build something? On whose land did you build it? How easy is it for you to simply go and start building on land anywhere in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, and unless it's behind God's back? So if, especially if you build it in a shanty town where other people, they have to know you building, and the people who own the land have to know you building. So if you are illegal in building, how that even get to be an issue for you as an illegal? If you are illegal, the law should be enforced, period. Period. If you build contrary to the law, Bahamian or non-Bahamian, the law should be enforced, period. Why are you conflating the two? Why are you conflating the two? You run straight past the Bahamian to get to the Haitian illegal unbuilding? Man, come on, right? So you're right that that a Bahamian citizen building contrary to the building code, or anybody, the law should be enforced. Why the confusion? Ain't no confusion. I am not confused about what the government is doing down in Shantytown. I'm asking questions about what really is the government doing? Which policy is being pursued down there? That's what I am asking. And I ask, is it one, the other, or both, or something else? No confusion here. You're tearing down the buildings. Who building you tearing down? Do you know? Are they Bahamians, illegals? Whose buildings are they tearing down? This text says, good day, wonderful show. Can you tell me how persons attain permits to build structures that are in breach of their conveyance? For example, split levels in areas zoned for single structures, building beyond boundary lines, etc. I know in one instance, a friend of mine reported an incident. Can you believe those unethical people at town planning? I'm talking about supervisory level, identified him to neighborhood. He had reported there has been chaos ever since. No question but that. How does it happen? You can get it by corruption. You can have corrupt inspectors and corrupt authorities who permit and allow things to happen. There's no question about that. That doesn't mean everybody in the department is corrupt. That doesn't mean everybody in the situation does it, but it is possible. It is quite possible. And we know it happens. And that is exactly part of how those buildings got built in those shanty towns. Don't let nobody think them people sneak in the dark and I can build them buildings. They didn't do that. Say, I conveyed it wrong, but you are not confused. You clarify it for me. I meant the confusion is about the court ruling. Oh, okay. All right. This text says, you are correct. This pandering needs to stop. We have been playing with the lives with people for decades. It's past time to address this longstanding problem. Keep up the good work and continue to speak truth to power. The issue, there are many issues in our country that are not as simple as the one-liners and brief interventions people get to make on these shows. More sophisticated and complicated. We have a call on the line. Go ahead, caller, we're listening to you.
Hello.
Hi.
Yeah, good afternoon. Thanks for answering the call. Okay, so I want to share my view here, Mr. Laing. The ruling that came from the judge today, I think it was an appropriate ruling yesterday. I think it was appropriate, and here's why I say that.
Okay.
Those persons who owned those houses that they were bulldozing, they did not just show up yesterday. Mm-hmm. They did not show up last week. They didn't show up last month. They were here for years. They are people who were displaced by Hurricane Dorian that came out of the mud and the other shantytown areas. But here's the situation. Right. Here's the duplicity with this whole thing.
Okay.
They were illegal buildings without building codes in the mud for decades.
Yes.
People were living there. They grew their families. Their generations grew out of the mud.
Yes.
Now that Dorian came and devastated the place and blew the mud apart, these are people who have been displaced.
Yes.
They were working for Bahamians. Some of them were working for politicians. Some of them was, and in all due respect, I'm not demeaning them when I use this term, they were my Haitian. People were, that is why they were there. They were there.
Yes.
They came in the country illegally, yes, but they were held and allowed to remain in the country because influential people were using them for their cheap labor, almost to the extent probably a form of slavery to some degree.
Were they not living there when there was a by-election in North Africa?
Yes, exactly. So this is a part of our problem. Here's where I think the ruling is trying to draw attention to when it says they need to do it, rethink it. These people were living in the Bahamas, were being accommodated in the mud. No one was touching them. Nobody was bulldozing the houses. Nobody was saying illegal structure. Now that the mud has been displaced, these people have been displaced, and they're looking for some place to live. The courts are not going to allow you to inhumanely treat people like that, who you've accommodated for years. Mm-hmm. You've allowed them to live there for years, and now that they don't have a house, where are they supposed to go? Think about it. Where are they supposed to live? On the streets? Are they to go to a life of crime? These are people who are living here. So the question is, there's a couple of things. We need to address the immigration issue as it relates to children of Haitian parents who were born in this country and still cannot get citizenship. They can't work. We school them. We feed them. We nurse them when they get sick. But when they graduate high school, they can't get a job because they don't have a nationality on paper. That is wrong. And secondly, if these people were in a place that you were permitting and it got blew away, I think what the court is really saying is you need to find some place to accommodate these people, to regularize them, to treat them like human beings. Yes, the land they're on is not their land. Yes, the structures may not be legal, but they didn't just not become legal. They were illegal when they were in the mud, and you didn't do anything then. So now that you want to use what Dorian did now to justify regularizing things, that's not the right way to do it. Find housing for these people, even if it means building something, or get some more igloos. House them in igloos. All right, give them some place to live under a controlled environment where they don't be all over people's land, squatting and taking over ownership of people's land. Because they are humans. There's a human part of this. And then the other part of it, we have to ask ourselves too, where's our Christianity? These are people who we've used their labor, and these are our friends and our family. These are our kids went to school with them. We know them. And it's okay for us to allow them to live in the bushes? Is that Christian? Where's our love for the stranger, for the one that's displaced? Yes, let them. I agree they should obey the laws. I agree they should come in compliance with our laws. But you have to meet them somewhere where they can be functioning as contributing to our country legally. Instead of just pushing them away, instead of just forcing them to create shanty towns, instead of being happy with them living in the bush. Come on. This is the Bahamas. We shouldn't be happy with people living in the bush. Those houses that were broken down, those people have nowhere to live. What are you expecting? Are we happy that they're living in the bush after you break down the houses? That is not Christian. So we brought this problem on ourselves, and I think the government needs to really, really think hard about how they're going to fix the immigration portion as it relates to these persons who've been here for 30, 40 years. All right, kids who were born here, we got to do something to regularize them so we can start to change this culture and this view that Haitians are less than. They are human beings.
The person who was born here wasn't
asked to be born here. So why are you treating them like less than a human being? Regularize them, let them become citizens, get the NIB number, let them start working, let them start paying taxes, let them start buying land. Let them start applying for work permit, for building permits. Let them start doing things according to the law of this country. But you cannot ignore the fact that these are displaced humans.
I appreciate it very much, man. Thank you very much. Very well said. Thank you very much. I think we have another caller on the line. Go ahead, caller. Hi, go ahead, caller. Okay. We don't have another call on the line. Okay. This text says the last caller is 100%. I agree with him completely. He said duplicitous. I say complicitous. Complicit. I'm encouraged to hear that there are like-minded Bahamians who share my view. Okay. This text says, what a sermon. boy, it was a sermon for sure. Very, very well said by that gentleman, for sure. We have a text here, some text here. Says, if the property is our crown land, the government has the right to demolish it. If the property is private, then the private owner has to remove them. Demolishing is irrelevant. You are missing the whole point. And the government don't have a right to do anything. The court says to them that they don't have the right to do so. So how do you argue with that now, right? Yeah, the government has a right to.
Yeah.
Okay, hi, caller, go ahead.
Yes, good afternoon, Mr. Laing. How are you, sir?
I'm good. And yourself?
Wonderful. It could be better, but thank God for the climate that is, because there's nothing God can do.
Okay.
What I'm calling for, I heard the program for the past 30 minutes, and this program has really turned into something emotional, especially the last caller, you know. And the government is getting exactly what it wanted out of it, the emotion, you know, because there it is, you know, the election is in the air. And these people are human beings, you know, and like the gentleman said, everybody got one or two or three my high shit. Okay, I work with some, and I go to Haitian barber, I go to Haitian tailor shop, you know, and I've got Haitian friends, and the parking boys at the food store, they're all Haitian descent, okay, not some of them, all of them, okay, and they've got females there and all, you know. What I'm trying to say is that Mr. Madison being a lawyer, and Mr. Vanessa being a QC, Fred is a QC. Can't this be worked more seriously and also to be productive? But like the last caller say, they don't want to do it because they just use it for political football. What I'm really calling for is that the cost of it, now they're going to appeal it, it's going to go to a Privy Council, and then nothing is free. Okay, we've had many other court cases that the Attorney General's Office have lost and cost us many. We had two QCs appointed to other cases. We've been asking questions of how much it cost the country. Well, we've never gotten an answer. Now you're going into another one to cost us some more money? Come on, man. What kind of bill are you putting on top of our grand jury head? You know, thanks for letting me share, sir.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate you calling. This Texas, they don't care if those people live or die. It's disgraceful. This text says, do we have another call on the line? Go ahead, caller, if we have another caller.
Yes.
No?
The line.
Yes.
C. Allen Johnson.
Hey, C. Allen, how you doing?
Yes. Now, we often, in these debates, we often conflate things, even to a convoluted conversation. But you asked a number of questions. And one, this is, The shanty town within itself, for me, is simply a housing and a question of humanity. Separate and apart from the fact that you may have an immigration problem, but you would have to assume that if 80% of the individuals from the survey is said to be legal or of Bahamian descent.
So I wasn't confused when I thought the number was very high, right? So you said,
yes,
I recalled 70% or 80%.
Right, but here's the problem with that. But at the same time, report says there may be as much as 40,000 persons who may not be properly documented in the country. So if you didn't find 40,000 individuals in those shanty towns, then the illegal problem is across the diaspora of the archipelago.
But we know that to be true, C. Allen. You live in Freeport, Grandmama, and you know that illegal Haitians are integrated into middle-income communities in Freeport.
And that's my point. So that's what I'm saying to you. So for us to combine these issues, and so simply put is that the government itself seems to be lacking in its expressing its policy position on housing in the Bahamas, including regular housing as well as affordable housing. And so, because if you want to address an immigration issue, the government can simply come into town, come into parliament, and begin to have that debate. If they even want to bring about policy for housing, they can do the same thing. The problem with that is that, based on a study that I helped author for our client, it is anticipated that almost in the immediate, we need 20,000 housing units and about 10,000 a year just to catch pace to be finished in about five to six years. And so they look at those whole environments where you talk about, you know, in Grand Bahama, we know a whole south side of the island and 8 Mile Rock and others. And if you come right here in Marco City and in Pine Ridge and other places, and now over here in central Grand Bahama in these areas, I could show almost 15,000 needed homes in Grand Bahama alone. But the hurricane said that 10,340 homes was damaged or destroyed in Dorian, not counting the hurricane, the damage and other things before. And so when you begin to have the conversations with, you know, this is a housing issue because those people have been displaced. Even where they live for did not meet the standard. The mere fact is we're ignoring the human factor of individuals, legal, illegal, or whatever else you want, that is there. But let's come back to the immigration issue. I agree with what your previous caller, except for one word, he used the word citizenship. You know, even regularizing individuals, the only difference between citizenship and the other things that we can give is the right to vote. And so, you know, and we can set a pathway to citizenship if we want to have that conversation as it goes, and we can actually use technology.
But you have a pathway to citizenship in the Bahamas, brother. You have
I'm saying that doesn't address these arguments. I'm talking about a clear pathway, clear deadline.
Alan, there's a clear path to citizenship for anybody. Let me tell you something. What is holding up a lot of those citizenship for some of them people ain't nothing but politics. I ain't asking nobody.
No, but again, it goes for technology. I mean separate and apart. When you set rules and set it there, meet the guidelines, digitize the department or talk for digitization, be able to document the individuals within the country.
Right, but you're talking about operationalizing the process.
The biggest tragedy that I have is this housing issue, because cascaded upon the previous issues we talk about, the shanty towns that surround the Bahamas, when you use that definition, is the fact that we have an impending collision with this whole COVID thing, where you have thousands of bank loans mortgages that's been suspended, rent that the people have not actioned, and it's like so much things in the housing issue that if you could just simply speak to the housing issue as part of this so-called economic reset, we could actually have a clear path how to move forward out of it, whether it be with the banks, whether it be with landlords, whether it be with new housing, whether it will even cost individuals, if there can be a clear path to how we're going to deal with the housing, to actually go invest in affordable housing and multi-unit apartments and, whatever else. But we somehow keep using the emotive type of elections and immigration and everything.
We can talk about housing in a few days, so stay tuned and give me a call.
Thank you so much for allowing me to contribute. And so if we could just unconvolute and unconflate this conversation, I think we could move towards building a better Bahamas.
All right. Thanks a lot, C. I appreciate it. Do we have another caller on the line?
Yes, sir.
Hey, yes. Go right ahead, please.
How are you doing, man? Good show.
Father Palacios. Is that you?
Yeah.
Thank you for calling, sir. How are you?
Yeah, I couldn't resist, man. I was on the road. I said, now let me call in and offer him a little 5 cents. Might only
please,
be 2 cents.
We know coming from you can be more than 5 cents, but please offer your valuable thoughts.
Okay. First of all, up front, let me say that the government has not only a right, but indeed a duty to enforce the law without fear or favor. And so demolition of the shanty town in principle has my full support, to the extent that if something is built illegally, then it should be removed. The government has the right and indeed, as I said, the duty to remove it. Yes. But of course, it should be straight across the board. But even before they go to do it, I think that the government could have been more proactive, and this is consecutive governments in this area. If you are serious that the shanty towns should not increase, then your officers should be the ones to go and see, even police officers. You see structures are being built. Am I not right in saying that when a permit is given, the permit number, building permit number, is visibly displayed so that when officers, is that correct? So that when officers pass by, they could see. Now, if you know almost by definition, very little in the shanty town, one, meets the code, or it's illegally built on property that does not belong to the builder, then you need to be more proactive. Stop this building. I think that is at the stage where we were not only talking about enforcing the law, but taking a preemptive strike to avoid all of this extremely big loss to people who have invested so much. Now, I made the point. It shouldn't have been there in the first place. But the human compassion says, do not do this. It will be destroyed. Now, in fact, it shouldn't really be completed. Okay, that's one point I want to make. The Honorable Ellsworth Johnson is a member of the church where I'm the assisting priest since I'm retired. And he was in the congregation two Sundays before when I was preaching, and he's often there. And what I said, among other things, is that we must not have a selective enforcement of the law. Yes, as I said, those shanty towns should not be there. They should be taken care of. But those many of them, the Haitians, have reached the age of 18, and consecutive governments have not given them the right that they have under the Constitution to be registered as citizens having attained that age, except, am I correct in saying, public policy and national security, right? In other words, if you have been of good behavior for 18 years and there's no reason to deny you, then you ought to be procedurally.
I don't think there is an exception clause in that provision.
I check it out. I think so. Because don't forget, the government always has a right to do that.
Yes, yes.
Let's face it.
Yes,
if a fella is in a gang, straight through, at age 18, I believe you have a right to say you will not be registered as a citizen in this country. Because you've been a thief, you've been to jail, and you're 18 yet. Why should I register you as a citizen?
Well, the thing about it is, anytime you're making an application, the recipient of the applicant, unless the law says so, always has the right to deny it. So you and I are in agreement.
our bishops, consecutive bishops, I've worked under three bishops in a particular category of management, right? And whenever the charge is being written, we've always put in the clause, not the clause, but advice to the nation. Persons who have a right to be here should have their status regularized. Those who are needed in the country and have applied legitimately for status of work permit, they should be given it again on certain conditions. And those who are not should be invited to leave, failing which they will be forced to leave. That has always been the Anglican Church's position. And I think that's most Bahamians think that way. But I also like the part, and I said that in church on Sunday, so we really need to make sure that when these youngsters become 18, isn't it an irony that we spend all that money on them, and when they're 18, able to get a job, pay taxes, get further education, we frustrate them. And many of them leave, or they go off to school, they don't come back, and we could really use their skills.
But Father, you want to hear something insidious about this, right? I want you to think about this for a moment. Here you are, you have cabinet ministers, right? These are your governors sitting around a table examining an application by a person who was born in the Bahamas, lived in the Bahamas, schooled in the Bahamas all their lives, right? In 99% of the cases, without any issue related to crime or criminality at all. I ain't asking nobody because I've been there, right?
Right.
And you're sitting, so this group of people sitting around there, what could be in their heads about denying that person that citizenship right outside of politics? See if you could find a reason to deny it outside of politics.
You know what happens? People then say, oh, that government gave so many of them citizenship. But
politics?
Let the people know that is the law. You
politics?
Know, to do otherwise is to break the law, okay? Now, the church is deadly silent on this whole, church generally speaking, is deadly silent on this whole issue of the demolition of the shanty towns. And I challenge some of my Christian brothers to look, not only at the issue of Pride Month and the gay issue, die the only issue. We have to be careful that we don't lose credibility by only focusing on this so-called gay agenda.
But there are only three sins in the Bahamas, Father, and you know that. Homosexuality, abortion, and sometimes adultery, depending on who asking the question.
Yeah, that's so unfortunate. But I challenge some of my Christian brothers elsewhere. Y'all got to speak up. I would really like to see a more comprehensive approach given to Abaco, with some pastors sitting down, a patient extract, etc. Sit down. What do we need in Abaco? We need housing. We need labor. You could hardly get a Bahamian to work on a construction site in Nassau. You think many of us are going to leave Nassau, leave our girlfriend over here, our baby mama, and be suspicious of somebody hitting on her, and we going to Abaco to work? Let's sit down, man. You know, Jesus, the Lord said, let us reason together, says the Lord. Let's see how we could come up with some kind of a workable solution to regularize some people who would help with the rebuilding of Abaco. You can't get, am I not correct in saying, you can't get a big structure built in Nassau without Haitian input.
And you have people in Abaco and them right now sitting around waiting for somebody to be able to not build them a roof, you know, not build them a wall up their building, just to be able to put in some closets and thing like that, and can't find nobody.
That's the point. Really ought to be a whole comprehensive look at the labor issue. But in addition to that, I like the point you made. I say, boy, Zhivargo preaching today. You said that the law is like the lowest common denominator, so to speak. It is like the basic expectation of civility. Thou shalt not kill. And when I call you offline, I said, that's why the Beatitudes are so important. And one of our young priests spoke on that this morning in the Anglican devotion. Jesus said, you have heard that it was said of old, thou shalt not kill. But I say to you, even if you have anger in your heart, you have heard that it was said of old, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say to you, even if you look lustily at a woman, you are already committing adultery. In other words, Jesus said, he called us and he continues to call us to a higher standard of accountability. And that's where we need to be going as we talk about being a Christian nation born out of Christian values, etc. Thanks for your time, man. And
thank you very much, Father. I appreciate your calling and always.
God bless you.
You too, sir. You too.
Okay, good.
Do we have another call on the line? Do I have another call on the line? Okay. We have a text here that says, Mr. Laing, are we seriously asking the question of what we should do with illegals? No. Nobody has asked that question. Nobody is seeking to answer that question. So just so you know, the answer is no. We're not asking that question. It says, send them to their country of origin. Okay, there you go. That's a sophisticated, very direct answer to a question you raised, because we didn't raise it in this show. Say, to the ancestors of those born to the illegals, they should follow too. If Haiti won't accept them, then they are stateless and they are now available for the U.S. to process them. Man, stop talking nonsense. I wouldn't even go on with the rest of that. Come on, man. Let's wake up. Let's be sensible. Say, tell Father I don't have the franchise on. You preaching today, so around you. this text says, to Father Palacios' point, they, the government, also have a right to execute the law without favor or ill will. If there was an impediment realized, they, the government, should have gone to a court and wrapped themselves in judicious deportment. Yet they, the government, seem to be comfortable with cavalier behavior for the purpose of expediency, especially when perpetrated by a governing administration. Now, Mr. Desmond Bannister seems to again be attacking in a most callous fashion the seat of justice, which is a functioning court of law, with his borderline contemptuous remarks in the press today. Oh, I didn't see any remarks by the minister. I didn't see them. I don't know. Take a picture and send me. I didn't see. So always good to hear from Father Palacios. Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. You hear that caller? I mean, see that? Yeah, see that texter representing that little that community of people about what to do with the Haitians and what should happen and could happen and so forth and so forth. Man, stop. Y'all stop. The court now. Another set of justices could come behind and disagree with the judge, Justice Grant Thompson. That is possible. But that is not relevant to the thoughts around this issue for me, which is that approached in a manner that is more, let me use this word gently, more comprehensive, I think some of these other things could be avoided. Okay? And so that's the call here. All right? This can't be about your little angst against Haitians. Okay? This can't be about that. Because no one is going to get Zhivargo Laing to say, any Haitian person who leaves Haiti to land in the Bahamas in a way contrary to the laws of the Bahamas is owed anything but humane treatment. That's all you're owed. You should face the full brunt of the law under law enforcement, but you are owed humane treatment. That's everybody is owed that. That is not even negotiable. Okay? So we ain't talking about no. So don't, some of you, what you try to do is you try to couch it in the worst ways. Oh, these people are coming here illegally. They don't. No, we ain't talking about them right now. So that's easy for you. See, that's what your brain could wrap around the illegal person. How about your brain now wrap around the Bahamian who is in the shantytown and the legal resident who is in the shantytown? Can your brain wrap around what is to be done and should be done with them? Can your brain concentrate on what is to be done with them? See, let me tell you something. What you're doing is not uncommon. A lot of us do it. What happens is when we have easy, simple issues to do, like let me give you an example. If someone you know murdered someone is drowning, and someone you know, and your son is drowning, who would you save? That's easy. So your brain have no problems. I can go save my son. But then somebody asks you, if your two sons are drowning, one is the eldest and one is the youngest, what do? You may still make a decision, but now your brain starts to get confuddled. Because it ain't that simple no more. And this is what some of you do. You go to the drowning murderer versus my son scenario. So that's where you can wrap yourself around an argument and speak passionately about it. But what you will not do is say, what is to be done with that Bahamian who lives in the shantytown or that legal resident who lives in the shantytown? Forget the illegal for the moment. According to the survey, however disputed you think it is, 80% of the people in the place were Bahamians or legal. Now, let me tell y'all what is so insidious about this too for y'all. Some of you, listen to me. The government is tearing down the shantytown, notwithstanding the government said its findings was 80% of people never Bahamian illegals. The only way, what some of you are doing to hang on to, that's the right thing to do is just think about the 20% who was illegal. Chatter down. Too much Haitians. Too much illegal Haitians. What about the Bahamians and the legal residents? What about them? What You can't kick them out. You can't kick the Bahamians out of the country. What about them? How about that? Can you speak to that? As others have, as Father and those have called in and spoken to it. But no, some of you, you can't. You cannot shake the issue of the illegal Asian immigrants to put your mind for a moment on these other people. So I expect your thoughts about the illegal Asian. We've heard those for years now from some of you. For years, y'all don't have an ounce of compassion for them. I ain't talking about whether you send them home or not. That ain't nothing to do with compassion. If they break the law, put the law on them. But humanity, listen, we are required. You know, every Bahamian citizen in Fox Hill Prison charged before the courts and convicted before the courts is now regarded as having broken the laws of the Bahamas. That's what they're regarded as having done. But do you know what? There is a requirement, whether it is done or not, to treat them humanely. A requirement. Even the one who's there for what has been regarded as the worst of the worst, there is a requirement to treat them humanely. And when you don't treat them humanely, you know what the Privy Council has done? Said no, commute their sentence from death to life. Because the Privy Council said, you, that person, notwithstanding their guilt before the courts, you mistreated them. And therefore, you commute their sentence from life to death. I mean, from death to life. So what do you think of the folks who live in a place where, for whatever reason, this is the life they can live? And you decide, okay, where you're living can't be livable. What then? What next? You can't even wrap your head around what to do with them. And so is there any wonder that your leadership will follow your sentiments? Do you wonder? And then when the same leadership now does something that you don't like, you wonder why. You wonder why. You know why? Because the scriptures say, do unto others what you let them do to you. You're listening to Z Live. We're going to take a break. We'll be back after this break.
I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid to take a stand.
The Sourdough King is back at Burger King Nassau. This fan favorite features 2 quarter-pound savory flame-grilled beef patties topped with thick-cut smoked bacon, 4 slices of melted American cheese, ketchup, and creamy mayonnaise, all on toasted sourdough slices. Get your sourdough sandwich as a single or a double and add ice-cold Pepsi and fries or onion rings for a perfect way to fill your day. The flame-grilled Sourdough King is only here for a limited time and only available at Burger King Nassau, where taste is king.
Sheila, you okay? I see smoke coming from your window.
Chad, Johnny Moe's burning down the house frying chicken.
Your kitchen is a mess. You have insurance?
If I have insurance, I pulled my phone out, pull up the Royal Star Assurance app, and in no time, I was on live chat with RSA rep, sent pics of the damage, filed my claim on the spot.
Wow, I don't think my insurance got that kind of...
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
You work hard. Shouldn't your money be working hard too? RF Mutual Funds are designed to put your money to work with some of the best performing investment funds in the market and a range of funds to suit your unique needs and risk tolerance. So when you're hard at work, you can be confident your money is too. Put your money to work with RF Mutual Funds. Call us at 603-6000 or visit rfgroup.com to learn more. RF, money at work.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, quality.
I'm not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand.
Yeah. gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Tuesday afternoon. Do we have a call on the line? No? Okay. This text says Bannister was very contemptuous when interviewed outside cabinet this afternoon. The clip was played in the last break. He basically construed the ruling to mean that anyone could build a structure on anyone's land with impunity, called it ridiculous or something like that. And I'm not going to take your word for it. I'll wait till I hear it myself because I did something during the break. So I didn't, sorry. This text says, what can be done with the 80% of Bahamians in the shanty towns? We have shelters for them. Do we? Where are the shelters? Please tell me where the shelters are. See, this is your, where the shelters are, what address? Who's the we have the shelters for them? Can you please, I'm going to give you some time to text me back. Tell me where the shelters are, please. This is something we've been doing from you in government, Mr. Laing. Really? When I was in government, we had no shelter for them. And I was in government. Where the shelters were? Please tell me. So I'm also questioning the 80% reported because I want to know who are real Bahamians and who are paper Bahamians. We need to investigate. Again, who are real Bahamians and who are paper Bahamians is an ignorant statement. I want you to get offended when I say it. It is an ignorant statement. Ignorant statement. When you get sworn in as a Bahamian, you are as much a Bahamian as the person who was born in the Bahamas according to the constitution and the laws to make them a Bahamian, because you and them both get to vote. The only difference between somebody who's naturalized as a Bahamian is their ability to pass on that citizenship naturally. But don't give me this paper Bahamian versus non-paper Bahamian. I keep telling y'all, some of you, because you seem to be unenlightened about this fact, so let me help you. If you were born before July 10th, 1973, you were born a British subject. You were a subject of the empire of the British colonies. And on the approval and passage of the Constitution of the Bahamas, a paper, you were made a citizen on July 10, 1973. So use a paper, Bahamian. So am I. So stop talking nonsense. Nonsense. But who's real and who's paper? And you don't think it's 80%. Why? Who should listen to you? Did you do a count? Did you take a survey? You have no authority to question it. Right? You could question it, but you ain't got no authority to do it. And just your questioning means nothing because you did nothing to try and get better information. Says, Mr. Laing, all governments should be held responsible. I remember under your watch, there was a fire. The then prime minister gave them $10,000 to rebuild, so they were supported and added for a long time. I understand this government gave them 2 months notice. First of all, you are late to the dance. Because on shows ago, I said every Bahamian administration has to take responsibility for allowing shantytowns to exist. So you're late to the thing. So if you thought that was a stick, you're late to the park, man. You know, I didn't confess my sins on that score. Okay. Now should be responsible. So now that you've held us responsible, how does that advance your cause outside of your satisfying yourself that you just said they're all responsible? Okay, now you remember a fire. What fire? I knew that there was a fire somewhere, but you said that the Bahamian government gave them $10,000. Gave who $10,000? Who's the them? Who the them? I didn't tell you all before. When you're talking to some people, you're not altogether talking to people who are unenlightened and will accept any nonsense you say. Who are the them that was the $10,000 given to? Please help us. Give us some information and we'll help you with that. So this person sends me list of hurricane shelters for New Providence. Man, please. Please stop. That was after the hurricane. Where the shelters are now? That those shelters were for all the displaced hurricane persons, wherever they found themselves in Grand Bahama or Abaco. All on them. All on them. They were for shantytown occupants. All you're trying to do now is save yourself. But your boat is sinking because your heart is being exposed. So it's a great show as usual. I have news for everyone on this issue of Bahamian and non-Bahamian. If anyone in the Bahamas takes the ancestry test when the results come back, they don't even say Bahamian. don't say it. I don't know what it would say. What would it say? If you take the test for ancestry test and take it far back, every single one of us come from Africa. That's every one of us come from two people in Africa. Anyways, so now the government has to contend with the court ruling. So, and for those people who say the government, you know, has a right to, it may have a right to, but it ain't got no right right now under the present law, because the ruling now binds the government's hand in a certain way. And that is one of the reasons why the government is now seeking an appeal to the situation. That's legal. Those are legal proceedings beyond my knowledge and expertise. I do know that in the circumstance, though, what is it about? What is it? What is it really about? Is it really? You demolish the buildings. Why? Because they are in breach of the building code. And this is something that is applied across the Bahamas. So presumably people were occupying or seeking to occupy those. Okay. Why? Why were they seeking to occupy them? Just in defiance of you? Just because if they were illegal and seeking to occupy the place, if you can so brilliantly determine that that place is not habitable, then might your investigatory efforts not lead you to discover who these illegal persons are and to deal with them according with the law? But if these persons were Bahamians or legal residents and you are able to demolish their property, then, or that place where they abided or sought to abide, then what? What else does the policy call for? What else does the situation call for that might reflect the best efforts of a government of the Bahamas is the question. Yes, you get the breathe a sigh of relief because people get to say, yeah, the government did a good job. Tear down those shanty towns. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. By some. Yes. But that's it? That's the reward? That's the end game? Really? That's us? That's it? I think we can do better. I think we must do better. I think we can see better. Anyways, we shall have to see. We shall have to see. I do know one thing. Something is happening in our world. And in our world, deep divisions are being created or widened between us and them. We are creating this scenario of us and the others. And that is a path to hell. That is a path to hell. America, that great beacon and bastion of democracy and melting pot of integration, is now seeing the fragility of that us against them, of that otherness syndrome. And I pray that it can find a way back from that brink. And it was a fissure widened by a leader. That's why we have to be careful. Anyway, God bless you all. Y'all have a great evening. You've been listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. Nahaja Black is up next. We'll talk to you again tomorrow.
Take a stand, everybody.